Tabletop Bellhop is here to answer your gaming and game night questions.
For the better part of the last 5 years, that has meant Sean and I here letting you know of our thoughts on games or sharing gaming advice. The whole time, though, Deanna has been with us, but in the background, running the website, editing my work, helping us with SEO and more.
Well, she has joined us on the show a few times over the years. We decided this year to have her on more often. It's been working out well, and the fan response has been very positive. So we decided to make her a permanent part of the podcast.
Now, since Sean and I have been at this for quite some time, and everyone has had plenty of time to get to know both of us, both just through listening to our episodes as well as through our AMA-style episodes, we thought it'd be worth doing something to give you all a chance to get to know Deanna a bit better. Now, while I've noted her preferences is for heavier games and her dislike of co-ops and dexterity games many times, but this is a chance to actually hear it from the source and ask any questions you have of our newest edition.
Well, Dee, before we get to any of the grilling, is there anything you want to say?
This is not coffee.
That is not coffee at all. Okay.
That is not coffee. I'm having a beer. Good evening, folks.
So I gave our fans a bit of a heads up on this week's topic, and we had a couple of people in the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, which you can find at discord.tabletopbellhop.com, sending questions because they couldn't make it here tonight. So we're going to start off with two of those and then give the lobby some time to get some questions in. I already have some flowing in, so that's awesome. But we'll get to these two questions from our Discord first, and then we will open it up to the floor.
All right. Well, the first question comes from Paxinarian, who asks, what's a game about which you had really strong opinions that didn't get fully aired on the podcast because you were staying behind the scenes? While Mo usually gives your point of view, maybe there's a time when you would have elaborated, said it differently, or been more adamant.
Mo is so diplomatic when it comes to talking about games that sometimes we don't like, and I am just a little more harsh on that. And often I'll be like, this game is just dreadful, and Mo can look at it and say, no, I know who it's for. It's for this type of gamer, or this person would like it, or these are the good parts about it. And I'm working on being more analytical, because I will often sit down and I'll just go, I didn't like that. Why? I don't know. It sucked and I never want to play it again. And that's not helpful, particularly not in a game reviewer sense. I know that often if you're in the chat room when the guys were talking about games, I might add in things because I was in the chat room moderating even when I wasn't on the screen. I could not think of a particular example. And I also don't like to trash talk stuff. Like I said, I admire Mo's analytical skills and the fact that he can be diplomatic about it. I was trying to go through and pick some of my favorite games and ones that I didn't like. And I said, I have a hard time breaking down what I do and do not like about a game. Something I'm working on.
It is always tough because I run into some of that same difficulty. I've just had a lot more practice biting my tongue and not giving negative reviews because, you know, there's games we all don't like. But we're not here to say this game stinks. That's not what we do. As much as it might stink to me, Mo's right. There really are people who will enjoy a game. And even if it doesn't work for us, we're here to tell you who might enjoy it.
Yep. We said many, many times, or at least I've said, we both said, I think, not every game is for everyone. And that's awesome.
Yep.
That's what makes the industry what it is. And why is there such a wide variety of games on the market? And there's something out there for everyone.
The key words you listen to for in reviews is, well, Sean's a little bit harsher on that than I am, and things like that. Those are the keywords that that generally mean that someone has been biting their tongue.
No, but not to say that we totally sugarcoat it either, because we do give negative reviews. I don't want to give the wrong idea here, but Mo's just better at being analytical about it than I am.
So is there one in particular?
I couldn't think of one.
Not that you want to bash a game, but like something I was like, no, this is actually quite good. It's this. And you're like, nah, I didn't see what you saw there.
Oh, you know what? I don't like Night Cage. I don't care for it at all. And I think you might have said that I did at some point in the review, or implied that I did, because someone came up to me, and I can't remember who it was, at the event at the brewery, and was like, oh, so you liked that game, eh? You really dug it, even though it's cooperative? And I was like, no, that's a dirty lie. So there you go.
There we go.
I'd have to look at the review. We just published it. I can't remember what I said. I might have said my whole family enjoyed it or something like that.
Well, next we have a question from Brian Kurtz, who asks, Deanna, what's an example of a game that really surprised you before playing it? You were pretty sure it was going to feel or mechanically function a certain way, but when you played it, it turned out completely different.
Oh, gosh, that happens all the time. Just in the last little bit, there was dubious when we sat down to play it. I had no clue where that game was going, but while Mo was reading the rule book, he was so puzzled by it. It was fantastic. Pirate Scroll game that Mo broke out the other day that I thought looked like a kid's game and ended up being super strategic. I think I get consistently surprised by because we end up reviewing things that I might not have picked up at the store. Like if I went to the game store and I was looking on the shelves and I was picking up games, they are not necessarily the same ones that we end up reviewing, even though we are really picky about what we take to review. I mean, it's all three of us, and also sometimes we do get surprise items or items that are pushed on us in a way that we just can't politely say no. And then often those end up turning out to be great. So again, I am failing at thinking of examples. It happens all the time. I'm constantly surprised by games. I go in thinking that that looks terrible. I don't even want to play that. And then it's actually pretty good. And that happens fairly consistently because apparently I'm pessimistic.
Well, I think Social Deduction is one of those ones where we all kind of have a bit of a negative view about it, whereas Dubious, while it's Social Deduction, isn't really. And so that, you know, it went one way and then came another, and then we were told we had to take a specific game home from Origins if we wanted any of the other reviews, and it was a Social Deduction game that we were not excited to take home, but we ended up loving it. So, you know, there's a bunch of those that sort of pop up here and there.
Yeah, the two I can think of, Psychobabble being the one Sean's just alluding to, but also the Goblin, Kiss the Goblin.
Kiss the Goblin. That game doesn't look like much. I had no, I barely got it talked into coming and sitting down at the table to play it. I had no interest in that game. It's actually super fun for a party game, for that style of game. Not the kind of stuff I usually dig.
There we go. All right, well, we're going to move into the lobby now with some live questions. We've got the question here. Oh, things are changing in front of me as I go.
Sorry.
From Eggman.
Just breaking up. One person has sent a lot of questions, which we do appreciate. I'm just trying to break it up.
All right. Well, from Eggman Jr., what is your favorite game of all time, comma, what is your favorite game of the last year?
You know, for the longest time, I would say that was Trajan. That was definitely my favorite game. I really dig a good point salad, but I haven't played it in forever. And we played Marrakesh the other day, and I think it might replace Trajan for me. I don't know. There are so many games I like. I was actually doing the this or that Meeple Pub thing, trying to figure out my top 20 because I floundered at making a list on my own, but that thing is so time intensive. I wasted hours on it and I didn't finish. But it did have me thinking about some older ones that I like that I haven't played in a long time. Like I really dig Attica and Hacienda and Turn and Taxis and Steam and Russian Railroads. Those are all older ones that I haven't hit the table in a long time that I really dig. For games of the last year, we played Hamburg the other day and I am in love with it. Oh, goodness. What else do I really like? I like Marrakesh. I like Tapestry. Tapestry I can play on Board Game Arena all day long.
I think we're going back more than a year for that one.
Yeah, we are. I only just tried Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition this year, and I dig it. I like a crunchy point salad.
Trajan was the first. And it would, up until you played Marrakesh, I think Trajan would have remained that game for you, and now you just have to play Trajan again to compare to Marrakesh to see which of those two is gonna take the lead overall.
I gotta say, here's the question that I always sit down, and this is how I answer this one when people ask me. Out of everything you mentioned, if we're gonna start, Sean's gonna come over right now and we're gonna play a game. What do you want to play?
Oh, I want to show Sean Hamburg because we just played it the other day. And he hasn't.
That's what I go with. That's why I always say that my top game of right now is this. Not my top game of all time. Top game of right now is this, because that's what I want to go play right now. Mm-hmm. And we all know that the best game in your collection is the one that hits your table.
All right. Well, moving on to a question from Roger. Deanna, what board game you dreaded or didn't want to play ended up giving you a pleasant surprise?
So, which is similar to the last question.
It is, but the one that immediately came to mind for this was the Deadlies. We only took it to be polite. I had no interest in this game. It was described to me as Uno on crack. And I was like, all right, well, let's open it up and play it to get it out of the way because we have an obligation to it. And it was super fun. We loved it from the very first time we played it, have played it with zillions of different groups, and everyone we have shown it to loves it. And it is just a stupid, simple game. And I don't usually love stupid, simple games. And I love that game. And I dreaded it. I didn't want to play it. But I mean, I think Mo sees often, anytime we have to review a party game, a dex game, social deduction game, that's it. I don't want to play them. And if I end up liking it, it's a nice surprise. And we've had a couple of those surprises recently with co-op games that I've enjoyed. So,
all right. Well, on the same tone, Tech asks, I know you aren't a big fan of dexterity games, but what was it about Catch the Moon that made you play it?
I was forced to play it, but I don't mind that one. Honestly, what made me play it was Mo brought me out to a coffee shop and put it in front of me and said, this is Catch the Moon, and I wasn't going to get up and leave. So, but I like it. I don't mind that one. It's okay for a dex game. I also don't mind Hamster Roll, but honestly, I could think of 8 million things I would rather play than any dex game on the planet.
We have another question here from Pax. How do you think your perspective on games and gaming differs from Mo's and mine based on your identity and life experiences, being a woman, being a mom, where you grew up or early experiences?
I've been a lifelong gamer. I would say I've been a gamer since I was like 7 or 8. I played Dark Tower. I was into Redbox D&D. I think Mo and Sean and I had a lot of the same early experiences, and we also grew up in the same city. But as far as being a woman in gaming, that's actually part of why I had a conversation with Mo about being more visible on the podcast, because I don't think there are a lot of women that are visible in board gaming that are older women. Like, you know, I'm pushing 50. You don't see a lot of older women that are visible in board gaming content creation, in RPGs more so than board gaming, I feel. I loved going to Gamma this year and just seeing how many women there were that were store owners and in retail and in the publishing side of things. I didn't sit down to demo a game at Gamma Expo where I was the only female at the table, so that was cool. Mm-hmm. I'm not even going to get into the fact that, yes, I've had terrible, stupid cliche-like experiences as a female gamer over the years, so that's certainly tainted my experiences.
All right, well, Eggman Jr. asks, what convention would you like to attend that you've never been to, assuming the cost and time wasn't an issue?
Not Gen Con, because the pictures of the crowds make me want to, no, maybe like PAX Unplugged, or like one of the Dice Tower ones, something like that. If money and time is not an issue, go on one of those cruise ship ones. There we go. They do a Dice Tower cruise, don't they?
I've always wanted to go to the one in Ottawa. The big Ottawa one always appealed to me. And I know you like Ottawa. I don't know if there's one in Quebec.
Well, if there was, I would assume French.
But yeah, Board Game Geek Con's always interested me. Because again, that's not a big one. Because Dee and I are on the same page when it comes to the crowds. That's a no-no. Mo's, I think, the only one of us who actually wants to go to Gen Con.
Got another one from Pax here. What's the mark that you feel you've been able to put on the podcast or the Bellhop universe? What are you most proud of?
I'm proud of the website. I built that thing. It's mine. When we first started out, my friend Aaron helped me get it set up. But since then, she has been consumed by life. And so she's not always on hand to help me out, and I have to figure out how the heck to do it myself. So I am very proud of our website, just the editing and everything about the website. I like it. I'm pleased with it. If it sucks, maybe write me and tell me, but maybe I don't want to know. And then the other thing recently is I've been taking over on the Instagram account for Tabletop Bellhop, and I've been doing reels every day, but I've only started like not even 2 weeks that I've been doing that. But that's something that I've been having some fun with. So there's that. I got Mo to go to the park and play with board games, and I took video of it. So that was fun.
And I think one thing that probably doesn't get recognition, or at least enough recognition, is your SEO work, even on just little things like the show titles. You basically have had your hand in almost every show title all the way along, because you're the one who knows and understands the SEO and the you know, the no, you want to make sure this word's in there and you got to repeat this and that, just to give us that little extra boost we hope we might get eventually over time and in the long term content and get us to where our views are. That's D. I mean, that's we, you know, Mo comes up with ideas and I toss some stuff out there, but the final determination generally comes down to D and what is best for long-term view counts and things.
Yep. Like I said, I'm proud of the website. I'm proud of the traffic we get to the website, which that's from all the tweaking and SEO stuff. Yep.
So Eggman Jr. asks, besides board games, do you have another hobby you enjoy?
Not recently. It's like there's not enough hours in the day since we started doing this professionally. What else do I like? I like video games, but like JRPG style video games like Dragon Quest and stuff. I like books, but I had vision issues, which meant I'm only now finally starting to be able to read books again with any like for more than 10, 15 minutes at a go. So that's nice. I really missed it. Well, what the heck else do I do?
Comic books, graphic novels,
comic books, graphic novels, books, more books. I like books
shopping and games. For used books. I'd say one of your hobbies used to be collecting books.
Yeah, for sure.
You don't like we used to go and like always ask to look at the you know the back rooms at the bookstores and behind the glass cases and you're always looking for first editions of specific books. I'll let you talk about which ones you like.
I have a large-ish collection of like first printing rare really old stuff. I started collecting really old books when I was like 10. I go to garage sales, and if I could find a book that was from 1900 or older, like I'd buy it, right? Like I was like, yeah. And now all that stuff that was 100 years old then is like 130 years old now. So I have an entire bookshelf that's just all books that are over 100 years old, and I would get anything if it was 100 years old. I have weird books on Canadian history, bad, weird romance novels. You have no idea, as long as it was 100 years old. And one time, I bought one, I brought it home, and it was full of pressed four-leaf clovers in the back. So that amused me. I found like 100-year-old pressed four-leaf clovers.
All right, well, moving on that same topic, what genre would you say you like best in books?
Sci-fi, fantasy, comparative folktales and fairy tales, and then classical Greece and ancient Rome nonfiction stuff. All of that. Oh, and young adult.
Not books on marketing and SEO.
No, though I read those, but I don't like them.
All right. Well, Eggman Jr. Asks, you said you're not a big co-op fan, but recently have mentioned a few that you enjoyed. Is there a game type that you don't like and haven't had a game change your mind?
I really do not like social deduction, like the werewolf style of game. I've yet to find something to change my mind on that, really. And dexterity games, flicking games. Like if I'm playing that, it's only because I want to be polite and there's other people there that want to be playing that.
What about real time?
Real time. Oh gosh, no. No, that's not happening. No, there's no real time. What is that one that Fuse? That's bad. Fuse? There's that space game. Is it, which one is the Space Alert where you have to go real time? No, that's terrible. We do not do real time.
Although now you say that, but didn't you, and maybe correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't you somewhat enjoy the train passing game?
I did. That one was okay. And it had dex elements and yeah, right. So I have found some dexterity games that are okay. I've yet to find a flicking game I enjoy at all. I yet to find anything that's speed based that I like, and social deduction, no.
And the train game Sean's mentioning is Rail Pass.
Rail Pass. Yes, that's it.
Yes.
Which I still have never actually played.
You should try it. I was just thinking about that one when I was going through and trying to rank all the games.
Maybe that one should come out next Walkerville.
Put it on the menu.
Mo, I think this next question is for you to ask.
Well, it comes from Eggman, but it's how did we meet?
Well, we went to the same high school, but we actually met through the local BBS scene. The online bulletin boards that predated the what you think of as the internets, if you all don't know what I'm talking about. And Mo was running a game of Warhammer Fantasy RPG that he was starting to run on the local BBS, and I had started playing in that game. But I mean, I think we were vaguely aware of each other and chatting on the BBSs. I mean, it was a small sort of community. So yeah, we started dating when we were in grade 12, when I was like 18. And so we have been together for forever. I don't even know. I'm bad because I don't know how many years we've been dating. I don't know how many years we've been married.
Only 12 years less than Mo and I have known each other.
Yes, not much.
Which seemed like a long time back then, but now it doesn't seem like a very long time at all. All right, we're getting on to some other things here. What's your favorite food?
Sushi.
There we go.
I answered that one in the chat already for you.
Sushi.
And favorite movie, even though Mo can't spell.
I'm really bad at just picking one of something. Geesh. I don't know. I really liked Labyrinth growing up as a kid. I think, like, who didn't? But don't play that game. It's awful. That doesn't count as a game.
Yeah, that one I don't even think I was all that nice about.
I like the musical Camelot. What else do I like? Something more modern. I'm drawing a blank. I'm really bad at picking exact things. Sorry.
All right. We got any other questions coming up from the lobby here?
So one of the questions to get into a bit more detail, you mentioned you were a lifelong gamer. Someone did ask, did you play games before meeting Mo? Do you want to expand on what you
played? Oh, heck yeah. Yes. But to the detriment of my friends who just wanted to go shopping at the mall. So let's see, what did I play? Oh, Stop Thief. That was really good. Electronic Detective. Dark Tower. Those are all ones that I loved when I was a kid. Plus like Scrabble and Trivia Pursuit and all that stuff. Like, we played games a lot in my household, and most of it was because I was forcing people to do it. So I have a brother and a sister, and if you have siblings, you probably know that thing where you trade. You're like, I will do this thing for you if only you will sit down and play Dark Tower with me. Yeah. So I'll help you with your laundry, but you got to play this game with me. It happened a lot. Yeah, and I got into Redbox D&D when I was like in grade 7. I remember I wanted to buy it in grade 5, and I had saved up money to buy it, and my mom would not let me get it because of the whole satanic panic thing. It wasn't so much that. She thought I was going to go into the sewers and die or something. She was really opposed to me. She didn't think I could understand the difference between fiction and reality, and she had concerns. So it took me 2 years of begging her before she would allow me to buy the box set. And I could not get anyone to play it with me. None of my friends at the time had any interest in it. And my mom ended up learning the game and becoming the DM so that I could play. And it was like her and my brother. But I mean, we did that on and off for maybe 1 or 2 years. It wasn't a big thing, but it was very cool that she did that. And then I tried an RPG here or there in my teenage years. None of it ever went well. I did not have welcoming experiences at the table until I started dating Mo, and then got heavily into RPGs at that point because I was the university club I started going to and role playing there. And then my journey is pretty much the same as Mo's because we were together, and eventually we couldn't get our role playing group together anymore and started playing Catan and getting into board games heavily and all of that.
Favorite role playing game? Favorites, some of your favorites?
D&D with skills and powers. I still dig that. Warhammer Fantasy. Like the original Warhammer Fantasy. Not modern pass the stick role playing. Get off my lawn.
You made Jeff Seuss cry, but he's not in the chat room.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'll get you into a PBTA game sometime. Maybe I'll get you into a supers game and see if we can't get you to pass the stick. Although honestly, Masks isn't even as granola and crunchy as some of the stuff out there. It's not like Microscope.
Pretty traditional.
Yeah, it's not like Microscope or something, or one of the completely improv ones. Eggman asks, have you played the re-implementation of Stop Thief that Restoration Games put out?
Nope. I'd love to. I haven't played the new version of Dark Tower either. I super want it. But yeah, no, I haven't tried it.
Yeah, the buzz has died off on that. You don't see anyone talking about Dark Tower anymore. I wonder if it kind of
flopped. Don't care. I have personal internal buzz.
I mean, that game, to be fair, that game is kind of niche. And especially if you don't have the fond memories of it, I don't know how often it's going to get to the table. Even if it's a great game, even if you love it. you know, how often it's going to hit the table. And
there you go. Eggman owns it. So we'll have to plan something. Oh, maybe the next barbershop.
Oh, wow. Okay. Dark Tower for me was, I went over to my aunt and uncles who lived down in Florida, and they didn't have kids, and it was boring at their house. And then my uncle went into his closet and pulled down this game. And I went, wow, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And I loved it so much that he told me I could take it home with me. And that's how I got my copy of Dark Tower.
Eggman points out that it is a way different game than the original. The most divergent of any of the restoration implementations, but in a good way.
Okay, that I was going to say, it was scary for a minute.
I was relatively aware of that. Like, I have been paying attention to it. It's been on my radar, so I'm super keen to try it.
All right, well, Roger's asking, are there any books about board games or gaming in general that you really like?
I can't think of anything. Are there any good books about board gaming? Not that I've run into yet.
As I say, for all the research we do and stuff we do know, buying nonfiction books on board gaming isn't really anything we really
know. No, I have yet. I've looked at some. I know Mo's gotten some books on like the history of D&D and stuff that he's read through and I've picked up and read parts of. So no, the answer is no.
No, the only thing I would say is maybe the Gamma magazine, because that's actually surprisingly good.
Actually, I really enjoy getting that. I was shocked by how even the advertorials that are in there, because like the publishers pay to be in there and have, you know, write-ups on their upcoming games and stuff. But I they're usually very well written and interesting and worth reading. So I even like the advertorials.
Yeah, they're very insider info. We're like, why did we do this? Why did we do it this way? How did we go that way? Which is perfect for Gamma, right? Which is an organization where everyone's supposed to be helping each other out. So they're written from a perspective of board game insiders reading it. So it's like there was a really good one on the art project and why they went with that art style and why they went with Institute Trait and what they're trying to do and the push for like what the op is doing, trying to get more into the strategy game market and not just be known as the Monopoly company. And those articles are fascinating.
Yeah, I had read through the magazine first, dog-eared it, gave it to Mo and went, no, you have to read this one, this one, this one.
Yeah, it's interesting. When it comes to gaming nonfiction, a lot of what's out there is either the giant encyclopedic tome, which is just fact after fact after fact. And to be frank, a lot of it exists on Board Game Geek. You don't need a book for it. Or very directed, opinionated topics and discussions of topics, generally with some sort of angle to them or something. but there's a lot of that out there. So unfortunately, there isn't a lot of really high quality, what I would call board game journalism out there in the science fiction. It tends to be either dry encyclopedic or biased in one way or another.
Yeah, it's not science fiction. That's the problem, Sean. I bought a graphic novel for the girls last summer that was about how to design a board game for kids, which I thought looked pretty cool, but then they didn't actually design a board game. So maybe the book was a flop. I don't know.
I'm personally curious about, like, Jeff Engelstein has written a few books. So has, I'm blanking out on a different designer. I know Sen's been involved in a couple books with Banana Chan, stuff like that. But yeah, that's not something we've ever really dove into. It's like Deanna says, time in the day, right? Like, I'm much more likely going to go on Board Game Geek and read a thread that's interesting me about a topic than to pick up a full physical book to read. I'm going to read a physical book right now. It's going to be Cyberpunk Red because that's what I'm currently reading.
Eggman Jr. asks, possibly referring to someone in the chat room else, have you played a prototype by a local designer that you really liked?
There was this spider game that I played one time that was made by this guy called Roger. It was pretty cool. It was still a prototype. He was still tweaking it and I haven't gone back and played it again.
Yeah, we need to play more. I hear there's one coming that features monkeys.
The rumors have been flying.
Because this goes back to your Pax's question about being a mom. What have you done to pass on your love of the board game hobby to our kids?
I was just thinking about this the other day about how exciting it is that they are now old enough to play the games that I like. And I don't mean that in a bad way, because we really cherry picked what kids games we've played over the years. And like, they've played a lot of hobby games over the years. But I'm like, they're now old enough that I can be like, guys, you got to come and play them all. Come downstairs. I have 72 games I want to introduce you to. I like that. I don't know. Must have done something right. They both like games. And I love that Gwen is running the board game club at her school. I just get tickled pink by that. And I love when she comes and talks to me afterwards and she's like, well, this is the type of people that we're getting and this is what they're interested in, and the breakdown of trying to figure out what she's going to bring next week and how to teach games and stuff. It's super fun talking that over with her. And I think I've said this on the podcast before. I don't know. I know I've said it to Mo and Sean. I just love that my kids think, because both of our children are girls. We have two daughters, right? Which we talk about all the time. I love that my kids think gaming is for girls. Like what? Why wouldn't it be? They have there's zero barrier for entry in their opinion. So I like that.
Yeah, actually, the board game club my daughter runs is all but one are women.
Yeah, so awesome. Most weeks, there's more girls than guys there. So that's kind of cool.
So we have a first time chatter asking question tonight. Thank you very much, Cult Cardboard. Asking D, what's your hidden gem game that most people overlooked when it came out?
Oh, I have been really failing at naming particular games tonight. Let me see if I can think of something. Give me a moment. I have a slow thinking brain. Zensu. I love Zensu. People are not talking about Zensu, and I do not understand why. It was originally put out by, I think it's Cheatwell Games, which is a UK company, and it was localized here by Outset Media in North America. No one's talking about that game. I do not get it because I think it's phenomenal.
The fact that you win almost every game probably helps that to some degree.
No, I just, thanks. We'll talk about Targi later in the show. I never win that game. I still like it. So that's not the deciding factor.
We did have a compliment from Tech that I think is worth calling out for those listening at home. I love when she comes out to the events and teaches games. So people appreciate her teaching, which I have to call out because she hates teaching.
She does it and she does it well. And I'm so proud of her because I could not have done that when I was 16. I actually had written some of this in the show notes earlier, which is why I didn't the show notes for later in the show, which is why I didn't say it. But like, she comes out to these events and teaches total strangers who are adults how to play games. When I was in high school, I could not have done that. I would have been like, excuse me, I need to go eat my shoes. I'm not capable of even speaking English.
Well, but I think it helps because of the welcoming and open gaming environment you guys have helped create at your home. She hasn't run into the sort of negative experiences that you did early on, both at the role-playing club and at gaming at cons, even somewhat recently at cons, where, you know, people just chose not to take you seriously when we all know perfectly well you'd wipe the floor with them if you actually played them in a decent game. And she hasn't had that experience, so she isn't necessarily as anxious about the potential for that happening if she sits down and shows what she knows to adults.
Yeah, but it's cool. Mm-hmm. And it's part of what I love about the local gaming community too, and those public play events. Mm-hmm. It's great.
All right, based on everything it said, is there anything you want to add, Deanna, that didn't come up or that you think people should know or that you want our listeners and fans to know?
Nothing is coming to mind. I thought I saw something in the chat earlier that I missed.
So while you're thinking about that, Cult Cardboard does have one more for you. This will probably be the last question. But again, I'm going to give Deanna a chance to say anything she wants to say and say her piece before we move on. If I may ask another question, what game mechanic do you want to see more of? And what's one that you think is overused?
Oh, I would like to see more Moncalas. I dig it in Trajan. I dig it in... Oh, it's not Gold West. It's the other...
Gold West has Mancala. Yeah,
that is it. I am getting it right. Thank you. Gold West. So yeah, I would like to see more Mancala. I dig that. What is overused? I don't know. I mean, we're seeing a lot of trends, but I can't think of anything that's really just sick of it. So I can't think of anything that I'm sick of. So I'm going to pass on that portion of the question. Sorry.
All right. Tech has a request. He's never been taught a game by Deanna. So you have a request for our next, Brews and Beers event at the Walkerville Brewery happening this month on the 23rd. Quick shout out there for anyone who happens to be local. Next one's on the 23rd. Maybe we'll get Deanna to teach Tech and at least one of his daughters. Maybe you can get both out this week next time to play.
What do you want to learn? Distilled?
How about Trajan?
I don't want to teach Trajan to anyone. I want to play it. I hate teaching that game. Terraforming Mars Ares Expedition. I don't mind teaching that one.
All right, I'm going to ask one last question just because I want to know. If you had to send someone to your favorite, the content that you're most proud of from the Tabletop Bellhop.
Good gravy.
The website, the podcast, the YouTube videos, any of it that you've liked or that you were involved with.
That's a hard one. Hey, you know what? That reminds me. You know what stamp I put on the show is the fact that we do mystery games because Mo would never touch those. We would have never started doing the murder mystery games. And we keep doing them because I really enjoy playing them. And so does my mom. So I get all the credit for that. The fact that we actually do mysterious packages and stuff. What am I really proud of? I mean, the fact that we've been doing this for, it's almost 6 years, just the fact that we managed to do it continuously, all of that. But let's see, I really liked that episode that we did on Mystery Games, which was one of the first ones where I came and co-hosted. I was proud of that. I thought it turned out pretty good, particularly considering it was one of the first times when I was hosting and I had no clue what the heck I was doing, and I hate reading show notes. You guys have done so many good ones over the years.
Like how she picks the one that I'm not in. Thanks.
Well,
like the first episode,
I think that's a valid answer.
No, like, absolutely.
We put that together in like one afternoon, and
You guys turned out pretty good. Fantastic job.
On yeah, that. I was proud of it. It could have flopped so bad, and it was fine. You guys have done so many great ones over the years, and I usually like the philosophy ones, the ones where you and Mo were less scripted. And I'm just drawing a blank on any specifics because it all merges together into one long thing in my head. We've been doing it for so much.
Yeah, you know, Sean's Kickstarter rant is probably one of our least scripted episodes.
Cult Cardboard, that is such a fantastic game. Sorry, the chat room's talking about their unplayed games right now, and Tech is asking Deanna to teach Hamster Roll. We'll get Genevieve to teach you that one.
No, and I'm not... not playing Fuse. This is not Torment Deanna.
That's what's next, right? Is your initiation, your hazing. Now that we've done the AMA, we got to do the hazing. All right. Well, thank you everyone in the chat room for the awesome questions. Thank you those of you who aren't here who gave us questions ahead of time on Discord. Greatly appreciated. I hope everyone just got to know Deanna a little bit better.
Well, that's it for our talk with the no longer in the back room Deanna, our web wizard, Instagram influencer, and heavy gaming champion.
To chat more with her or any of us, just jump on the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, discord.tabletopbellhop.com, and start up a conversation there.